we can, comments our proceedings now. Let me welcome all of you to this special lecture by a very distinguished gentleman, General JJ Singh, on a topic which may appear to be relating to our history, but one which has a great deal of contemporary relevance in terms of ongoing boundary issues with China. Now, all of you know General JJ Singh very well. You're aware of his many faceted personality, his accomplishments as a public servant. He has been governor of Arunachal Pradesh. He served our armed forces with great distinction, rising to the highest level as Chief Army Staff, Chairman of Chief of Staff Committee. But today he is with us in a different persona, one of scholar. Now this aspect of his personality is known to many of us, but not that widely known. A very serious researcher on matters relating to defense and national security in general, and China in particular. In fact, I had the pleasure of seeing a dissertation on China a long time ago, well before he became army chief. So I'm aware of that dimension of his contributions to creating a well-informed discourse on China. And today he'll be talking about the genesis of Shimla conference, which, as you know, took place in 1913-14, and the impact of McMahon line boundary alignment, which emerged out of Shimla conference on India-China boundary negotiations. I'll not try to anticipate what General Singh is going to do, so I will turn to him. But before doing that, I would like to place on record our deep appreciation for India International Center joining us in hosting this important special lecture by General Singh. So on to General Singh now. Please come. And may I also welcome Mrs. Singh amidst us.
Privileged to be able to interact with this August gathering, and it's a vast subject, therefore even vaster is Sino-Indian relations, so this is only perhaps one segment of that kind of a vast canvas, and in 40 minutes I'll try and do justice to it. Thereafter I will have some time for question answers. Ladies and gentlemen, yes, Ambassador Kant talked about the historical perspective of the subject, but in my opinion, today, you are all well-read scholars, but what I wish to convey needs to be passed on to the majority. The majority is one which knows only the superficiality of this subject. They don't know the nuances, they don't know the details, and therefore for us, if we want to match our strides with China, we ought to be able to understand and know how the Chinese mind, their psyche, their culture, their way of life is to be studied by us in depth. Then alone will we be able to give a good account of ourselves in any dimension. So this boundary dispute has a profound effect on the contemporary history and evolution of the two Asian giants. The complex challenge has led to a brief but fierce war in 1962, and skirmishes and standoffs take place quite often, some of which come out in the media, some don't, but are resolved, let's say, to the credit of both countries without a shot being fired in anger. So since 1967, when we had a flare-up in Nathula, which was an armed skirmish resulting in a number of casualties, but more on the Chinese side than ours. After that, we've had a big standoff in Sundarumchu in 87, but we also had a recent flare-up in Doklam. So the point at issue is that there is something which is working, something which is gelling, which did not lead this kind of a face-off to get into an open conflict. And I'm sure you must have read some of these strategists who said, oh, there's a war coming up now. And everybody was very, those of them who prognosticated a war, were sure it'll happen. But some of them were not experts, I would say, or they exposed their naivete about international relations and India-China relations, right? We have a very complex issue, which is the boundary problem between China and us. And there are many ways to look at it. I would say that we are fortunate in a way that for centuries, both countries have lived in peace and have not had a clash of civilizations, though both are very ancient civilizations and very old, rich cultures and traditions and whatever else you say, both believe that they are the center of the universe in their own sphere, and the Chinese call themselves the Middle Kingdom. Now, between these two giants is sandwiched a country, an ancient country, ancient kingdom, which came up when the earth was remolded, and that's Tibet. There was historically, millions of years ago, this Death Sea between the Laurasian continent and the Indian subcontinent shared off and got into this, with the result the two plates collided and there was a tectonic movement of immense proportions. Perhaps civilizations got wiped out at that time, but new civilizations came up and new mountain chains came up, and today what we see Tibet is a actual result of this tectonic clash of two continent shelves. So what I want to highlight is that while we must know history also, but geography is very important. For anyone who wants to do research in a subject like what we are studying, or even related to strategic issues, the geostrategy part of it assumes very serious connotations, and it is, in my mind, a neglected sphere. Let me mention to you very blankly that forthrightly also, that in India, you have many experts articulating on a boundary issue, but they haven't actually studied the geostrategic dimension. They haven't peered at a map or a three-dimensional view in seriousness. India has been guilty of putting up wrong maps in official publications because our people have stopped reading atlases, and geography is a forgotten subject. Let's get back to it. We should know at a straight away one glance that this map shows Aksai Chin wrongly, or this map shows northeast wrongly, but some of them have got published, and therefore it doesn't show well for a country which is so proud of its ancient heritage and its uniqueness of being many cultures in many diverse people living together. Therefore, Tibet became the roof of the world because it was pushed up in terms which can't be described, but it is the place from where 7 or 8 major rivers of the world flow out. So if you take from the Chinese side, is the Huang Ho, then the Yangtze Kiang, then you have the Mekong and the Salween, Irrawaddy, and you have the Tsangpo and Brahmaputra, and you have this on India's west, the Indus River, Satluj also before that. So all these flow out of Tibet. So therefore, Tibet has great strategic importance. They say that Tibet will always have to be kept in mind when formulating any strategy in this part of Asia. I will bring out some of the nuances which impact on our present boundary negotiations and our efforts to resolve our boundary problem. Though, mind you, I am one of those who believe nature has given us a formidable boundary to begin with. We have the great Himalayan chain of mountains, and we have a very clear watershed and the boundaries which traditionally came up over centuries. That boundary was based on the watershed or the highest ridge line. On one side was Tibet and the other side was India. We were never neighbors, strictly speaking, with China. We were neighbors with Tibet, but not with China, really speaking. And the Chinese, in their own, if you read their literature and if you read their history, they do not talk of Himalayas at all. They talk of Kunlun. They may also talk of Karakoram in some ways because it figured in the boundary between Sinkiang and Jammu and Kashmir. But they never in their literature talk about Himalayas. The same way as we talk about Himalayas as the sacred land Deva Bhumi. It's in our scriptures and is considered the northern frontier of our country. So therefore, we have a very strong argument in our favor that south of the Himalayan watershed is India, has been India. And therefore, I'll go on further on this issue, but I want to say that we must give importance to geography and geostrategy. The famous geographer Will Durant has said, civilization exists by geological consent, subject to change without notice. Now, when the tectonic movement took place or may take place in the future, it will come without notice. Earthquakes don't give a warning. They come and they suddenly come and always at very difficult time. It's supposed to be named by Suez, a famous geographer, as Gondwana land, what was the Indian subcontinent, probably named derived from the Gonds of our central India region. It was about 45 to 50 million years ago. Now, what I'm saying is that people have a wrong idea that Tibet is perhaps a plateau, a raised plateau. Please believe me that it is being serrated and crumpled because of this collision. It has number of mountain ranges. For example, just to tell you, between Assam Plains and Mongolia, there are more or less 7 main mountain ranges which you have to traverse, and they are having passes which are at the height of 5,000 meters, about 17,000 to 18,000 feet. So for China to come across from the north of all this challenging terrain, or from the east coming into the west, that is a very different dimension I like to highlight. They have no mean task. They have made roads, In me and my wife traveled recently to China when Ambassador Kant was the ambassador, and we went to Sining and went beyond Sining into the Tibetan plateau. Now, Tibet originally is a huge area. Originally, as an ancient kingdom, was one third the size of the United States, and it's been sliced off over the years and over centuries. But now, present core of Tibet, which is called the Tibet Autonomous Region, is, I think, one third of the original Tibet, or 40% of original Tibet. And only one third of Tibetans live in this, the rest, two third, live in other parts of the Tibetan populated areas in China or in other countries, including India. So it is one, I would say, a very important fact to know that Tibet was a buffer between India and China. So the two giants never had a common border. And the British, in their imperial strategic design, did not want China to be breathing down their northern frontiers. And they wanted Tibet to be a very, very, very autonomous area, but under Chinese suzerainty. Now, you know, the British also must have been wizards, because they coined the word suzerainty. And one doesn't hear it much in reference to other countries or other parts of the world. But the Chinese don't have suzerainty as one of the terms which they practice. They have Shangko and another Chinese word for it, but it's there in my research. But they believe that they are sovereign powers, and sovereignty is what they believe in. And they kept playing the game with the British. Okay, we all right with that. But when it comes to push comes to shove, we will do what we want to do. So I'm trying to tell you that this part of the world has lot of nuances, and geographically big challenge for China. Till the mid 50s, would you believe that Chinese themselves, who were administrating Tibet, or their military who used to be trying to control Tibet, subjugate it, were getting their rations from Calcutta to Siliguri, Siliguri to Chumbi Valley, and going into Tibet, into Lhasa, and spreading to other parts, because it was impossible to get it from the other sides. There was only one road which was of some commercial value, which was called the Junglam, came in from Beijing and then came further in. And that road was also prone to a number of landslides and physical obstacles. Also, it was disturbed by the law and order situation prevailing there, a disturbed area, because there was the Kham tribe, that's area of Kham, and any Pa means the people. The people of Kham became Khampas, and you know that they have a very high reputation as warriors, the Khampa warriors. So you had a region of Kham, and you had the region of Amdo, which were on the eastern part of Tibet, and Tibet basically has a core called U-Stang. So that U-Stang is the area of Lhasa and the regions around it. And then they have Nagari on the western side. That region is where our sacred pilgrimage sites and famous Mansarovar and Kailash Parbat are. That area is called Nagari. And going up north, then you have the frozen desert of Aksai, Chin, and their own huge desert called Changtang. And people who live in that are only who are, let's say, herders or people who nomads who travel from one place to the other, and they are called the Changpas. So you have the Changpas, those who are in actual Tibet are the Tibetans. Then you have those who are living on the northern slopes of the main Himalayas. Now this I want to make it very clear, The northern slopes of the Himalayas are, the people, they are called Drukpas. And Tibetans did not like hotter climate, and they did not venture coming down to the southern slopes of the Himalayas, which was the domain of the tribes, or the Arunachal Pradesh tribes as we know them now. But they were very fierce, savage, and very dangerous people, because they did not want outsiders to come into the area. Their own territory was out of bounds for people from either Tibet or from the plains of Assam. So you had Tibet, the southern frontier of Tibet, being defined by geography more than anything else. Yes, most of us make a mistake thinking that this is a natural wall. Geography didn't make it easy for boundary makers. Geography didn't grow in cardinal directions. It is nature at its most original way. So you have an arch formed by the Himalayas, and of course very forbidding heights, but you also have rivers which have cut across this formidable barrier. They've taken maybe millions of years to make that gorge. The deepest gorge in the world is the Tsangpo Gorge. Tsangpo Gorge comes in from Tibet and enters in the Arunachal Pradesh region of Siang, where it's called Siang. Tsangpo becomes Siang, then it becomes the Dihang, and then it joins the Brahmaputra. So it's got three, four names. And also, the other river which comes in, cutting across the Himalayas, is on its west called Subansiri. A smaller one is called the Namjangchu, and on the east is the Lohit River. So in a distance of 1,000 kilometers, like from here to Srinagar, you have only four valleys through which the rivers cut across and come from dividing this mountain barrier. So these gorges, particularly the Siang Gorge, is the deepest in the world. It's most difficult, dangerous, and this river has never been used for whitewater rafting successfully. People have died, but they didn't succeed in coming down. Let me just tell you that there is a period, and to be precise, this period is up to 1913. Till that time, people were not sure where the Tsangpo disappears. Does it become the Irrawaddy? Does it become the Lohit? Does it become the Dibang? Does it become the Siang or any other? So they really did not know, and there were myths abounding about this river. The myths were that it falls from the heavens and Brahma ka ye aapke liye pradan hai, ek unka bakshish hai. But they didn't know exactly the course of this river, which was discovered by two intrepid adventurers, Captain Trevor Bailey and Bailey and I remember his name. There were two officers who went beyond the orders and to be able to cross from the Dibang Valley into the Tsangpo Gorge, and then they came along up to Tawang. That means they traveled on the northern, shall we say, Tsangpo Valley, which no one had done before. So they confirmed that this is the same river which becomes the Siang, and the Dibang is the Brahmaputra. The main flow or the Brahmaputra is from this river. Why I'm saying this is that where the rivers cut across the Himalayan range is we are having boundary problems in those areas. Where it is the watershed and is high, there nobody claiming it. There are some passes, but mainly is the gorges through where the rivers come in, that you have three, four spurs. So you can say this spur is the boundary or that spur is the boundary, depending upon local situations. But since there is not so much of population, it becomes more of a theoretical exercise. And really speaking, it means a few kilometers up and down, not a big deal for 1,070 kilometers boundary from Bhutan eastern extremity to the Burma Tri-Junction near the pass Taluk Pass. So therefore, this is the way I would say this frontier is. Now we need to see a bit of the history, because this inaccessible area was inhabited for centuries by people who call themselves Tibetans. They are different from the Han Chinese in facial features, in their build, in their language, in their culture and traditions, and in a way all superior civilizations, including the Chinese, think they are superior to all of the others in their periphery, and they are inferior to them culturally, otherwise development-wise, less developed, and so on and so forth. Now, what I'm trying to say is that these people who are Tibetans, as I said, there are three, four different regions, but by and large, they speak the language which is known as in their own Tibetan dialect, but it is derived from Buddhism. In the sense, the script which they are using is the script from India. Till then, they were having no written language, only spoken. So they derived their language from the Buddhist scriptures which went in, their scholars who came this side, or Chinese scholars who came this side. So the Buddhism influence was very deep in them. And in some places, it has also reverse direction come spilled over from the other side into the southern face. Now, I want to clarify this at this stage only. There is no place called South Tibet, which has come in recent usage. South Tibet was actually north of the Himalayas. That way, it's a very small width, the band between Lhasa and the northern slopes of Himalayas, the Tsangpo Valley, is not very much. Could be 200-300 kilometers or 400 kilometers at the most in certain areas. So that is South Tibet. Central Tibet is, or the core of Tibet, is the Lhasa area. And I told you in the west is the Changtang desert and frozen areas. On the east is Amdo and Kham. So really speaking, when you talk of South Tibet, it's a new word being coined only to buttress the claims which China is making for the Arunachal Pradesh. Otherwise, there is no such thing as South Tibet. There was some Chinese, some Tibetan influence, and as I said, the spillover of Buddhism from that side came in certain areas. Let's not deny that. But that was not to say that it was under their administration. It was religious ties, it was ecclesial ties, and nothing more. So, now, talking about the Tibetan, after they were isolated and they learned how to survive, they were fierce warriors. They were really speaking so fierce that at some stage they also invaded China. And their famous king of Tibet, he was given a Chinese princess Wenchen in marriage by the Chinese king. They also came in forays into India. They were a very acclaimed martial race. But then, you see, the king did not know that he is marrying a Buddhist lady. Princess Wenchen was a Buddhist lady. She believed in Buddhism. And also he had married a Nepalese princess, Trikuti. She was also Buddhist. So between these two queens, they converted him into Buddhism, and then Tibet became a totally Buddhist country. And not only that, they also became so pacific in their nature that they didn't know how to fight. They didn't know how to defend themselves. So a stage came where they needed somebody to protect them and defend them, and they had this relationship called Choyon, the priest and the disciple, Choyon. And the status of both were the same. The Dalai Lamas were the priests and the kings were their followers, and therefore the Dalai Lama never bowed in front of the king. So they became very peaceful, but at the same time very vulnerable. However, they were practically independent for many centuries, but after they became Buddhist, then they were having this kind of a relationship of being protected by the either the Mongols in the beginning, who gave them this kind of a relationship, and the Mongol kings gave the Dalai Lama his status and title, but they also made them temporal head in addition to being the religious head. So the unique example of somebody ruling a particular area as also being the religious head. So temporal and ecclesiastical powers were given by the Mongols to the Dalai Lama, and then the Dalai Lamas continued to retain these powers till such time that the Chinese in 1951 called it a liberation of Tibet, but then it meant that they were now in complete manner the masters of Tibet. I would say that the history of Tibet does give you a feeling that they were not always subordinate to someone or the other. So they have, but now today the situation is, as you all know, that is an autonomous region of China, but Chinese had assured the Britishers for almost 100 years that they will not make them a regular province of China, and they will keep them as autonomous as possible. But today it is being administered like a regular province. They have some autonomous, shall we say, autonomous features, but they are not very meaningful as it was intended. The Britishers had designed that Tibet should be autonomous but not independent. On the other hand, if you compare, the Mongolians were being supported by the Russians, and the Russians gave the Mongolians the Outer Mongolia. This is another riddle, you know, which most of us may be a bit surprised to hear. The Outer Mongolia is not in the heart of Mongolia. Ulaanbaatar is in Outer Mongolia. So you say, why should this not be inner? But the inner is closer to China. So the Inner Mongolia, similarly in Tibet, when they were trying to divide Tibet into inner and outer, which I'll talk about later, the inner Tibet was the one portion which was Amdo, Kham, closer to China, and outer Tibet was Lhasa and areas west of it. So this is the way it is amazing that you find how geography is being, in a way, wrongly being used to identify a certain area. But so the Russians, on the contrary, helped them to be independent. Whereas in the case of Imperial Great Britain, it didn't fit into their scheme of things. They felt that an independent Tibet may not be able to sustain itself, so be always vulnerable. And their fear was not of China. Their fear was of Russia. That Russian influence is there, and there's a gentleman called Agman Dorjev. He was the tutor of the 13th Dalai Lama, Gyatso. 13th Dalai Lama's tutor was Agman Dorjev, a Russian Buryat Mongol, a Buryat person from the northern part, close to Siberia, but they are very ardent Buddhists. He came and studied in Lhasa, and then he became his confidant, and he was with him all the time. So the British thought that Russians might come and begin to influence, and they were worried about their British Indian Empire. You see, British were not so much interested, I would say concerned, that national security of the Indian continent should be preserved as much as we feel now, but they felt that their imperial interests are more important. If it means that trade with China will get affected, then they might as well lose their mining rights, their railway rights and other things. So when they weighed it all, and when the viceroys used to project from here their views, then like all mandarins in every country, the Whitehall mandarins thought that they knew best, and they would tell them, you frontier boys don't say beyond, we can't have two policies for British policies. So if it's wrong, so be it. They were very sarcastic in saying no to projections of people from India. The viceroy, the governor, his military advisors, the chief of the Indian Army. So this is very important to bear in mind that they forsake Tibet for getting perhaps some concessions with China in trade and other things. So they have valued that more than purely looking at it from the strategic point of view. Now, I would say that having seen this geostrategic and political background, also the historical background, now we should say what resulted in the Shimla Convention. Why did the Shimla Conference take place? You see, the British created a situation which was very complicated for them. Till the time the Younghusband expedition went in into Lhasa, for almost a century, no foreigner had entered Lhasa. One major Bogle had gone, but thereafter there was no foreigner who was allowed to go into Lhasa. It was a forbidden city. Nowhere on the, you can't go in a secret way unless, of course, there were people who went as spies, disguised themselves, and there are famous spy stories which one hears. But many of them got caught and were tortured and killed. So therefore, the point is that it was not known terra incognito. And this area, when Younghusband's expedition went, before that, what caused the Younghusband expedition is that the Tibetans, the Dalai Lama the 13th, Gyatso, did not know much about the world. He was a small village boy, cocooned in the Potala, and he didn't know the world. So he heard stories that the British had acquired Darjeeling, the British had acquired Kalimpong. Darjeeling from the Sikkimese and Kalimpong from the Bhutanese. And they paid a compensation, but they just built it and they took it. They needed those places for recreational purposes more than strategic reasons. They wanted some places where they could go and cool off in the oppressive heat of the Bengal plains. But they got it, so the world traveled, because Sikkim was also under the influence of Tibet, and maybe intermarriages were there. So you know what happens, the word spreads that English are not good people. They've taken there, now if they come here, they'll take away something from us also. Well, the fact is that Dalai Lama did not reciprocate when the Viceroy sent him a letter to say trade should be enhanced, some other measures should be taken, but no. So therefore, the Viceroy's letters were returned unopened, and the Viceroy felt very offended. And that was the time, 1905 up to 1910, the zenith of the Raj period. So they couldn't take it. It was an insult. So they said, all right. But they were given a sanction only to go up to Shigatse, not to Lhasa. But when this thing happened, I would say that a good initiative taken by Younghusband. He felt that there will be no meaningful results, so he must press on to Lhasa. The Dalai Lama, Gyatso, he fled from there once he knew that their intention is to come to Lhasa. Therefore, once he fled, you will not believe me when I say he thought the British will pursue him, but the British had no such intentions. In fact, the British expedition was also a half-hearted attempt, because first they said go up to only Shigatse, then since nothing was achieved, they went forward. What I'm coming to is that he was very afraid that British might catch him and kill him. So he went 2,500 kilometers to Mongolia, to Ulaanbaatar, and he, I don't know how much of effort he had taken. He hid himself as a Mongolian, you know, a trader, and he concealed his identity and went away. But anyway, that was his first exile. What the British did, they started a whirlwind. The Younghusband expedition was the start point. The Chinese woke up that without any difficulty, without any opposition, a foreign country can reach up to the, you can say, guts of Tibet, and we couldn't do anything. And the Chinese were embarrassed very much because they were the suzerain powers, and at that time, the Ramban was there, but he was helpless. So the Chinese woke up. And surprise of all, that the British, after 15 days of getting the Younghusband, got 1904 convention signed by the Tibetans, in the absence of Dalai Lama, his authorized person, the various important monasteries, three of them are there, the abbot signed, and he got his agreement the way he wanted, and he was coming back. The Chinese started moving into Tibet then. They realized that we have to get into Tibet. So this, actually, this is a reaction to the British Younghusband expedition. What eventually happened is, Younghusband got in his agreement with the Tibetans that for 75 years, the British will have their presence in Chubi Valley. If that had happened, so you add 1904, it comes to 1979. We would have had a presence in Chubi Valley. And it may have become a different story. But again, the wise people sitting in Whitehall, London, they said, no, it's too much. And they also said, you ask them a reparation of 75 lakh rupees, it's too much. So make it 25 lakhs only. The Chinese now stepped in and they said, oh, we will pay this 25 lakhs. And in 3 years after that, you have to leave Chumbi. So that is the story of Chumbi Valley. Look at the strategic loss to us. But people sitting in London, as I said, had their own priorities. So they knew best and they made it clear. Right. So now we come to the nuances. You understand the real watershed. If you are taking the watershed principle from North Sikkim, it comes to a pass and goes to a mountain called Chomolhari. The Amochu flows from this north of south of it, and north of it the waters go into the Mochu. That was the agreement in 1890 between British and Chinese. That's the only agreement on the entire 4,057 kilometers of frontier between China and India today. That's the only portion where the Chinese have signed. So they can't get away from that. But then that is in one agreement. What I'm saying is that strictly speaking, if the British wanted, they could have made that the watershed using the principle, and the boundary should have run north of Amochu, where the source is. There's a pass there and go up to Chomolhari and then join the Bhutanese watershed. We now come to the fact that Shimla agreement was called for because the Chinese came in all over Tibet and also to the frontiers of Tibet. That means they came up to the crest line of the Himalayas. In some areas there were forays across, maybe only two or three places. Along is one area where they came in because there's the Lohit Valley. It's a low valley. In 9,000-10,000 feet is the altitude, not always snowbound. So they could come there. But yes, they tried to see other places, but they were not successful. And the tribes were very, very ferocious. You know, the Arunachal tribes, they had developed a very strong poison. They had the arrows which are poisoned, and they had hide behind foliage and let go these arrows, and whoever was hit by an arrow, like a snake bite, couldn't save himself. So therefore they scared people by using these kind of guerrilla tactics and ambushes, which then they had punjis and other things. They were very dangerous, as they won't come up front. So now what happened is that Chinese did not come anywhere in South Himalayas, the southern glaciers of Himalayas, not even in Mopa area, which is Tawang, where there is influence of the Tibetans. But as I mentioned earlier, religious influence. They used to collect money, but that was like dan, or you can say giving religious support, like donations, but not tax. So therefore, there was no administration, that they didn't have an administrator there, they didn't have schools, they didn't have any other thing like in Tibet they must have had. But this was not like that. So therefore, that claim is also nothing which can stand scrutiny. So really speaking, you know, just exploiting, and I know some people as governor, I went to some places, he said they were so harsh to us, he used a very soft language, but they would come and see our kitchens and see if there is a trace of rice. The Mongpas of Arunachal, or the tribes which were in, they have the Membas and they have the mayors in the Lohit Valley. Membas are in the Siang Valley. They are Buddhists. So they should come and search whether they had rice or not. Was there any leftover of rice in the pots? And if it was, then they were punished. So you know how I'm saying that all rice was supposed to go to the monasteries there for them. Then they could, you know, throw their weight around. The fact is, the tribals were very worried and anxious if any outsider came in, and they didn't allow them, and they used to barter. But people used to leave the barter trade on the border and not come across. Whether it was Subansiri, whether it was Lohit, whether it was Siang, they did not come into the tribal territory. They left it on the border and they traded there. The border is also therefore known. To say that there is no known border is not so, but which are formidable mountain massifs, there was no need, because north of it nobody went, and south of it was the tribal area. And there used to be hunters, hunter-gatherers mostly, so they were there everywhere in their areas. Now we also now look at that, why the British wanted the McMahon line, or it was not known as McMahon line, the name it derived later on, but a boundary between Tibet and between the rest of India. So they said, we have to have it, because the Chinese came in, reaction of Younghusband, Chinese forays, and then the British woke up, and then they sent the expedition to these tribal territories. And people say they had the inner line, the outer line. You know, you have read about it. The inner line, outer line were administrative boundaries, that the DC had a role to play administering justice. But beyond that, they let them under loose political control. They knew that in trouble they will have to come to us, and they had some agreements, Kabuliyats and other things with them. So really speaking, I'm telling you, whereas the other side are never present, the Chinese, neither the present or the past generation or a generation before that ever came into Arunachal or the southern part of the main Himalayan chain. So it is very clear, this one is an exaggerated claim if at all, because the British were not reaching up to the main mountain passes. That was because of their own choice, but that was not because anybody else had protected the tribals. So the tribals themselves were being looked after by the British. So I want to mention that he drew this line only because now they wanted to have a frontier which was logical, which had some traditional and customary background to it, or it was a watershed principle being applied, and wherever they did their recces and their surveys, they made a fantastic line, except for one place where they could not reach. Therefore, they made a geographical error, cartographic error, which we call that area of fishtails, where they have shown two wedges going, but they go deep into the Rongthorchu Valley of China. If China insists on it, they will be on a very weak wicket, because this will cut into the main axis going across the boundary, which goes from the east to the west up to the Siang Gorge. So I'm trying to say that it is a error because of lack of survey. And when they signed this McMahon line between the British and the Tibetans, because the Chinese were not party to it, they said if there are some corrections based on more survey, we'll amend it, we'll modify it. But that means over 1,070 kilometers, you may have a few kilometers here and there, nothing more than that. The main principle, main line cannot be bargained at all under any circumstances, and there's no locus standi, no logic. Further, I will go on to the McMahon line was drawn, as I said, the British had three, four strategic objectives. They wanted a secure northern boundary, and they felt if it is Tibetan controlled and Tibetan administered, it is safer than having a Chinese one. So therefore, they kept a buffer of Tibet entire along the entire stretch of this boundary, and they didn't allow the Chinese to have any place coterminous boundary with British India. Yes, with Myanmar and Burma of those days, there was along the northern. But then the Chinese have agreed to that boundary on the McMahon line. They've agreed to the Irrawaddy watershed. Then they've agreed to Nepal, the watershed. They've agreed by and large to the Bhutanese, except for one or two places. And therefore, there is no reason why they should use a different yardstick. And all along, they themselves knew. And also, if you take practical experience coming to the contemporary or last 30, 40 years when 62 operations finished, they went back because they realized they have come into a different area which they don't have legal title to. So really speaking, over here we are on a strong wicket. It is absolutely clear geographically, traditionally, culturally and otherwise, and by past experience, that it is part of our country. Now, when they were to have this conference, before that a very important milestone is the 12th August 1912, a memorandum which the British gave to the Chinese. Look here, you have violated all rules and regulations, you gave those promises, we let you go ahead with it, but we will not sit passively. We allow you suzerainty, and we are allowing you suzerainty even though Tibetans don't want you, but we also said that you should give them full autonomy, which you have gone back on your word, you reneged from your word. So therefore they said, we'll have a conference to decide the southern frontier of Tibet. And also we'll have the Tibetan representative, yours and British, on equal footing. You have to agree to this term, otherwise we will not have this. We'll have a separate one with the Tibetans and you'll be left out of it. So the Chinese were clear. They agreed to attend this conference where all three would be on an equal footing and on the same level. There was nobody superior, inferior. Because at that time when the conference was held, you know, it's how destiny plays a role. The Dalai Lama sitting in Darjeeling was praying, God help us, we are going to be subdued and submerged by this huge dragon. So what do we do? But to the rescue came the revolution of 1911, October. That revolution brought in a civil war in its wake. The revolution was against by the nationalist government of the new Republic of China against the Manchu Empire, the Qing dynasty. So when that happened, there were some army people who were supporting or loyalists of the Manchu Emperor, and some were for the nationalist government. So Tibetans didn't have to do much. Wherever they found Chinese, they killed them. They must have taken their sweet revenge over all the torture they went through, all the barbarities they went through, because the Chinese were ruthless. There was a general Chao Erfeng who came in 1905. Until 1910, he had destroyed many monasteries, killed a lot of lamas, killed a lot of civilians and others, and he was known as Butcher Chao. So they said, one day he will go and our turn will come. It was a phrase or a saying in Tibet. And anyway, this happened. So fortuitously for the Tibetans, the Chinese fought with themselves, plus they also became emboldened to kill them and eliminate them. So the stage came when there was not one Chinese, including no Amban. Amban was traditionally for three, four centuries there. Amban is like a pastor. Is this a warning? No? Sure? Anyone who wants me to wrap up, I am ready to wrap up, but it's so engrossing to me. I don't know how about you, but I feel that I can be given a little liberty.
No time limit.
Right. Thank you. Thank you. You can ask me after that any questions you like. So what happened is that the Dalai Lama was blessed by his own prayers, by his own God and Buddhaji, and therefore Chinese were eliminated from Tibet. The first time after 300 years they were independent in a way. But the British still didn't want them to get independence. They had some whiz kid who said, no, you will be autonomous, fully autonomous, but under suzerainty of China. Even at this stage, it's ironical. I mean, I'm just saying that, look at what history is, but anyway, the British, in their wisdom, thought that was the better solution, so they did it. Now, therefore, they had a conference. In the conference, first the Chinese Ivan Chen was there, and the Tibetan was Lonchen Chatra, and the Britisher was McMahon. He was their foreign secretary. So he was most in the picture about all the expeditions that had gone into the northeast, and Captain Bailey the recce's done. So he was the right man. Then why they had this conference in Shimla? They had this conference in Shimla. They were first having a thought of having it Darjeeling near Tibet and this and that. Then they realized that Darjeeling has Kalimpong nearby. Anyone of you who has been to Kalimpong was known as a famous espionage center. I've served there, so I know. You didn't talk to anybody because you didn't know who was who. So it could be anybody. So therefore they decided, no, there will be a lot of interference from the Chinese to the Tibetan, pressure on them, this, that. So we'll have it in a venue like Shimla. They had it in Shimla. And Shimla had the commander-in-chief of the British Indian Army's offices located there. And the governor used to come, the viceroy and governor general used to come there for the summer for 5-6 months. So the decision-making was very quick. The conference was helped by the map makers and everybody. So that was the reason Shimla was chosen. Now, Shimla, the conference started. It started in October. We have some differences. But these are, I would say, minor staff duties. In the army, we have major staff duties, meaning the core, and minor is peripherals. So therefore, these minor staff duties had, it was on the 6th or it was on the 13th. I think the date given by the British was 6th, and they met on the 6th. Whether you call it a formal meeting or not, they introduced each other, and then they said, okay, we'll have the meeting on the 13th. So some people say they didn't have a meeting on 6th. I said, why make an issue out of it? They met and they said hello and introduced each other, and the 13th was the first conference. Then they had for 9 months, seven meetings, formal meetings, and few informal meetings. Seven are recorded, and then they had one final one on 3rd of July, which is the 8th meeting. In the first meeting, the Tibetan gave their plans, their claims, and I will show you some slides at the end of my talk, because then you'll be able to concentrate on them, in which they made an area which is Tibet, according to them, where Tibetans live, and it is under Dalai Lama. So that was their claim. The Chinese said, no, this is wrong. This is our claim line. That was done on the next meeting, the second meeting. After that, since there was a 1,000 miles difference between the Chinese western frontier and the Tibetans eastern frontier. This was a place called Chiangta, about 200 miles from Lhasa. The Chinese wanted all that area to be part of China, and the Tibetans said, Tibetans lived up to Tachien Lu, the other side of Yangtze Kiang also. So now I'm telling you, I showed you Yangtze Kiang, Mekong, Salween, Irrawaddy, and Brahmaputra. They are all five rivers, massive rivers. But they, at one place, they are crossing every 50 kilometers, 50, 60 kilometers. You have a deep gorge, and then you climb a mountain of 14, 15,000. It's above Shimla and above Leh and above any other mountain most of us have climbed. So you kept going up and down, till you reached the destination. And very often, there were very heavy rains because this is part of the Southeast Asia monsoon belt. So you had very serious problems. What really went wrong for the Chinese was that the Tibetans would make this area very difficult to administer. So always it has been under either very loose control of Lhasa or no control of anybody. These Khampas were very, very fierce, and they didn't allow interference in their own practices. So that is how the eastern area of Tibet or the Kham area was, and even today, let me assure you, not only is tough terrain, the Chinese may have made many tunnels. They're very good at making tunnels, I can tell you, we have seen them. But then you can't prevent landslide, snow slides. It's very difficult there, very difficult. For them coming from east, from Chengdu side, to cross these 4-5 major rivers is not easy. So the McMahon line was eventually made based on a historical background, and people had been on the ground. Luckily, let me just say, it was touch and go. Yes, Captain Bailey and Captain Morshead. Morshead is an engineer, and they were serving with a theodolite. They were surveying all over these areas. Creditable research they have done. And I've read their report. Every day they walk 15-20 kilometers, and yet they did surveys. You know, it has to have some commitment from you to be able to do that survey and to be able to do that research. For 6 months they traveled maybe 1500 miles, 2000 kilometers, and they came back to Rangia. If you've been to East Rangia, is a small station, it was a station then also, and caught a train. They looked like ruffians and rag pickers, but they said, "Who are you? I'm so and so, but we have to reach Shimla." And they reached Shimla somehow. Somebody gave them money to buy the ticket, and they reached. And they brought information which confirmed the Tsangpo River being the same as the Siang, Dihang, and the Brahmaputra, and they brought this alignment of the mountains. You see, now I can see the top of this house here, the roof, but beyond that, if there is a higher mountain, it gets covered by the line of sight. I may not be able to see it, it may be higher. That's how Everest was not discovered in the first look, because it was behind the highest. You close, you don't see that there's a dead ground. So they didn't know if there's another range behind, so how can they draw a line? So he was actually lost. McMahon was lost. For a month he kept telling them, okay, you resolve it between yourselves, and he knew they'll get exhausted arguing with each other, the Chinese and the Tibetans. Finally they'll say, "Acha, ab kuch karo." So this is how, and he gained time, and Morshead and Bailey came, and they gave him the report based on which he drew a line, including the extremity towards the Bhutan side, extremity towards the Burma side. So that Bhutan tri-junction is from a pass called Mela, comes south, and then along the most prominent ridge, which is the Thagla ridge, comes into the Namjangchu and gets into the Zangnan Kudi. It's a huge range of 300-400 kilometers. When I say 300 kilometers, it's like from here to Ambala. You see a mountain range which is 20,000 and above with glaciers, that makes a barrier. So anyway, this is how they drew this line. I can tell you, anybody who is a serious map man who can read a map will say, hats off to them, they drew a very accurate line, even in those days with primitive survey equipment. And one place they went wrong was because they couldn't reach there, because up to 1912 the Chinese were floating around in Rima, which is other side of Along, but they didn't come into Arunachal. They kept north of Along. So let me just make it clear, they also knew where the boundaries are, but they wanted a boundary a little south of Along, because then they had some grand design of connecting Yunnan and Lhasa. That is their strategic design, which never happened because they didn't get to do that, and they couldn't do their survey. But they knew, their line was drawn. If anybody has time, please read some of these books where one line has been drawn when the Chinese made their claim. I told you Chiangta, then Chiangta, it comes to the Siang River, where the Great Bend is, and then it comes into Arunachal and joins northern Burma and goes to Yunnan. That was like you draw with your sword, a general draws a line in the sand, and it follows no features. He said, "This is the boundary." I suppose there was no other logic. There was no, not even their presence, not even their administration anywhere near. So what McMahon did till he could make a line, could decide, he said, "Aapas mein karo." And they went back to square one. He said, I don't budge. Then they both went to McMahon, "Please make the line." He drew the line based on lot of inputs which he received from Captain Bailey and Morshead, also General Bower's expedition on this side. Let me tell you, if you get to Arunachal, it's impossible to reach the watershed of the through those thick forests. They are impenetrable. So therefore many Rekis failed because they couldn't just go. And they are gorges, the rivers are in torrents, you cannot cross them. You drop a tree, it goes washed away like a straw. So fact is, they could do very basic research, and they did, you know, surveys with the trig heights of the peaks, and they joined them, and then they, but when they did it from the other side in Tibet, there is no vegetation, not the same vegetation which is here because of the rain, and they were able to take the bearings, and they made a very good survey. I'm telling you, if you go to the geographical survey of India and Dehradun, you still get their records. But that is how McMahon drew the line. Now we are sitting on the pig's back, because what is the relevance of that to today's boundary discussions? The relevance is that, look here, neither were the people from Tibet brought onto this side of the line, neither was the geography tampered with, and this line has been drawn. I think you didn't sign the McMahon line agreement or the Shimla conference agreement, then you lost a lot. Actually speaking, if the Chinese had signed it, but then Tibet would have been quasi-independent or very much more autonomous, because they were also agreeing to, you know, we have all heard of the red line, McMahon's red line, am I right? But there is a blue line. There's a blue line which is more important from the Chinese point of view. They rejected the Shimla Convention because the blue line they were not happy with, and also the red line, not with the Indian boundary, but the boundary when it goes into China in the northern part. The red line goes right up to the Kunlun Mountains. Yeah. Complete traverse of Tibet. I'll show it to you on the sketch. So they had a major problem with the blue line, and not the line across India. They didn't even perhaps know there's a place called Tawang, or they didn't even know there's South Tibet, which they have discovered now. I mean, I'm saying it a matter of factly. There were no even initial discussions, 1960 talks or so, you then with me, that there are no word South Tibet talked about that. So these are invention discoveries just to increase the bargaining power. Ladies and gentlemen, what the Chinese lost was also important. They lost that they could have an Amban in Lhasa. They lost a commitment by the British and Tibetans accepting it that they are part of China, but in an annexure, not on the main body, but they are under the suzerainty of China, and they are going to be autonomous, but inner Tibet will be not autonomous. They'll have to have like almost like a province of China. Outer Tibet will be autonomous. But anyway, whatever it is, if they had accepted it and what they would have done in that area, nobody can help you. If the British decided not to help Tibetans, they couldn't be helped by anybody else. So even in India, when 1951 Chinese came in, Tibetans asked us, help us. We also took a decision that A, we will not be in a position to help you, and therefore we said that we sympathize with you, but we can't really come to your rescue or to help you. This is your, I mean, you can take moral support from us. But that also, I think, was conditional to that we accepted the Tibetan suzerainty over, Chinese suzerainty over Tibet. We accepted the British condition and we continue with it. But in 54, we have gone one step ahead and said, well, we accept that it is a autonomous region and a part of China. And therefore, the Chinese treated it in a much more different way. Now, they lost having an Amban, they lost having trade with Tibet freely as they could have, and they lost the position of being the supreme authority. Instead of that, the British started using it as a sphere of influence of theirs. Now, today, what does it imply for us? I would like you to see the sketches, and then we will discuss on what its impact is. Can you please show this one? Now this, ladies and gentlemen, is what I have been talking about. This brown portion is Tibet. I mean, it is all very, very high. The highest altitude is shown in the deep brown color. So we must understand, this is heartland of China. From there, if anybody has to come here to these borders, he has to come across these four or five major rivers. No matter whatever they do, you can't fight geography, you can't fight nature. Also, it brings out that the watershed of the Himalayas became a natural frontier by and large no one can blame us for saying that the watershed principle should be applied and the passes are, like you take the central sector, Shipkila and all that, these are border passes. And they were known to be the divide, generally speaking. So therefore, minor issues can be raised, but no major issue can be raised. And just imagine for China, most of the people used to come like this and then come in here and go to Lhasa. They preferred that than to come overland because it was terrible and not safe. So people would get killed. You know, we have heard, don't do this, chamri udher dunga. That means I will de-skin you. This is what used to happen to the couriers carrying mail from here to the site. They used to be caught by khapas and skinned alive. I mean, it's a recorded fact. It's not that I'm trying to make it look very dramatic. But it was so bad. There was no governance there. And you can't deploy pickets on these 2,000 kilometers. And before the roads were developed, it used to take 6 to 8 months or 1 year to come from one side to the other, except from this side. This was the shortest route, and therefore it was British areas or British India or our area of sphere of interest. Now Chinese feel bad. That abhi tak wo Tibet mein in loko feeling hai. They have a feeling that they're, you know, it's part of our sphere. We say, well, listen, we can't change geography, we can't change history. They got Buddhism from us, they respect us for that. We also are close to them, in the nearest to them, and in a natural calamity of the worst kind, we will go and help them. As any nation will go and help any other friendly nation in distress. So my point is, this is what it is. We are located in an advantageous position from our side here, very close to, from Darjeeling and Kalimpong, Lhasa is 400 kilometers. From Darjeeling, Calcutta is 600 kilometers. It's even further. So therefore, it's the fact which we cannot deny. Now, when discussions take place, we have, as I try to build a thesis, a strong case for the boundary to go along the Himalayan watershed. And let us not call it McMahon line because it is just incidental that his name is being used. We should say, well, based on tradition, based on practices of culture and other things, and people, the ethnicity boundary should be running as, and minor changes here and there should not matter to anybody. I'm sure we all are mature enough to understand that we need to get over this boundary issue and go ahead and do better things. And as two countries, we are one third of the world. We ought not to be fighting with each other. We have to find a way out. But of course, I would say it should not be at a disadvantage to either side on level playing field and on pragmatic reasons and others. We have to find an answer. And I'm sure our mandarins, I maintain, in the 50s and 60s were a bit not that experienced and that sung in their thinking. Today we have a new breed. Here is an example. Ashok has been a front runner in China. He's been studying the Chinese. Now, I say we should have knowledge of the dragon and the Middle Kingdom. We should also have experts. I don't know if many people know Chinese, Mandarin, or they speak or write or understand. We have to have thousands, if not more. We have only 100. Kondapalli has written somewhere, I read it, he says, we can't find more than 100. And out of them, maybe only 10 high priests are the ones who talk all the time. The 90 are not even given a chance. But I think we should have more, many more, because that is how we'll be able to be equal to them. Another point I'm making, which is a very good point to take away, is that Chinese have become masters in handling democracies. They handle the British, they handle the Americans. 100 years ago when McMahon was sitting and Younghusband was fighting his way through crying, koi sunta hi nahi hai. He says, you know, then somebody says, my vision is there. He says, his vision is up to the next election, the distance to the next election. That is what the soldiers in the front were talking. I'm not joking. Democracies are democracies. It still remains the same today also. And the Chinese had their ambassador in London,
had their defense attaché, intelligence guys, they would report, by either to half-hearted approach, they are not supporting Younghusband. So if we don't do anything, or in McMahon line, we should not support them because they'll take advantage of us, we are weak. Let us not do anything, and they can't push you beyond a point. And that means they were two steps ahead of us. If I'm going to fight a boxing match with you, I must know you well. I must see your videos, what are your strong points, what are your weak points. I should know everything about you. We know much less about China than they know about us. So they are ahead of us. So it's an unfair match, if you ask me, frankly. So who's to realize it? All our policymakers, who all have to understand. Am I right, Ashok? Then we have to be more knowledgeable about the adversary, then we can take a better account. I would not say adversary today is a wrong thing to say. We should say that we are both, let's put it this way, trying to find our place under the sun, and we both can do it in a constructive engagement. That could be the bottom line. But the fact is, we must know more about them to be able to do so. Right, ladies and gentlemen, I think, forgive me for having taken some minutes extra, but I couldn't finish without saying what I had to say. It was my interaction. I'd like to ask you to field any questions.
Thank you very much, General, for that fascinating talk. Now, General has agreed to take some questions, but time left is limited. So what I'll request you to keep your questions rather brief. Please introduce yourself before asking questions. What we'll do, sir, wait a
minute.
All right,
that's good.
I'm Shastri Ramachandran. I'm a journalist who worked in India and China. When you express a view, as you expressed in your end note, that China is at an advantage for reasons A, B, C, that we need to make more effort to understand and to know about China, do you find yourself in a minority in both military, strategic, diplomatic, government, and political circles in India? Thank you.
Can we have one more? Please say again, I'm 70 plus.
I'm Sanjeev Srivastava, sir. I'm a researcher on American foreign policy, and also a close follower of Chinese studies. My question is that, as you said, that we have to understand more, we have to study more on about China, and also learn the art of diplomacy from them, because they are a bit ahead of us. So other than learning Mandarin, what else should we do? I mean, in terms of diplomatic engagement. Thank you.
I worked at the Institute of Social Sciences in Vasanpunj.
Social Sciences where?
In Vasanpunj.
Vasanpunj, yes.
Yes. I have been to Tibet and Lhasa in 87. And I believe my group was somewhat responsible for that, the rioting that happened afterwards. We were a monastic group. My interest in Tibet has been right from the time when I saw in the Statesman. I must have been, I don't know, I'm 72 now. So when that headline came, China annexes Tibet. So from that time, I've been interested in it. And one reason why we are so ignorant, we cannot even learn anything from a map like this, because I've lived 10 years in Nepal, and it's wrong to say that geography and everything else, history changes things, because the China has a train to Lhasa now, you know, an all-weather train with oxygen. And Nepal sees itself as a yam between two boulders, and it has acquiesced to China. So the influence, I can see that China could easily march into the heartland of India, which is Uttar Pradesh, through Nepal at some time, because the Indian road no longer exists. The Mandar Rajpath and things. Secondly, nobody lifted a finger when Akshay Chin, and I have read the Lok Sabha debates in 1957, when Akshay Chin was being, you know, breached, and the whole McMahon line was being completely ignored. And if you read the debates, you'll see that I really feel it was not just for the Karakoram Highway. There's a very great interest, apart from Arunachal, in the Ladakh area. Ladakh was also Western Tibet, as you know. Some of the lamas there say, you are in China now.
They call it the small Tibet. Yes.
Sabarong was the original capital in Western Tibet, the Zhangzhou capital,
yes.
You know, which is not Demchok and all those places. So we are ignorant because no Indian is allowed to have a map of a border area. And even your good self, you haven't given us a map showing, say, the McMahon line, and maybe you're not allowed to give it in a public place. So we have no access to maps, least of all topographical maps. And where there was a mistake, for example,
can you show the third slide also? This one. See now, if you see this slide, it shows you much better because it's a bigger scale. And this is the red line of McMahon. And sorry, it goes up like this, and it goes like this, goes end near Kumrum range. Now, this shows almost the tip of Aksai Chin. That means Aksai Chin was at that time considered to be part of British India. I mean, you see, then they show this. This is the red line, then this is the blue line. Okay, so this is up to this whole area was considered that China can take more control of it. That means don't make it a regular province, but uske niche kuch bhi karo. And this line shows, you know what, it shows the last minute changes to get China on board to sign the McMahon line. If you look at this, I've circled this area and circled on top also, there are three signatures here, that this end to this end and this line we are giving to China, that is proper China, not even inner Tibet. So they tried to get them on board. Bahut koshish kiya McMahon sahab ne, lekin Chinese ko udhar se hukum mil raha tha ki Angrez kamzor hain, they are not going to support McMahon beyond a certain limit, and therefore you don't agree. And there was one famous spy sitting in Calcutta. So that man, he was giving information, he had somebody in his inner coterie who was telling what the Tibetans are saying to him, and he was telling the Chinese government. So these things happen. But I'll answer your question. Rioting happened, ma'am, because of you. We can't go now. You have 67 years of rioting, so we can't go because Chinese blame Indians create problem there. So I don't think it was, you may just be imagining, but it's not the case. We have nothing like that in our minds, right? And therefore, what I'm saying is Chinese are very sensitive. If they're weak underbelly, they're worried about Tibet. Alright, then, yes, and geography, I can honestly tell you, I have walked physically. Okay, I have walked thousands of kilometers on this line here. Here, this is all above 10,000 feet. I have walked more than 1,000 kilometers. I can tell you it's very difficult. Aap trail se aajao, baad mein to yahan pe chadna hai aapko. Then you have to be on your 2 feet. The Chinese are one soldier family. Ek bacha hai unka. To maa baap rote hain ki yaar tum kahan ja rahe ho is frontier area mein, ye kahan ye hai, kahan Beijing hai, kahan Shanghai hai. Wo to bichare, they bribe their people not to post them here. So let me tell you, if we want to say the Chinese are 8 feet tall, Soviet, they are happy. Wo to chahte hain. In democracy's weaknesses are free press, are individual opinions. Why should our leaders go and meet the ambassador and say, Dokla mein kya ho raha hai? Why should they do? They should not do. That means he gets more importance. So they know how to play a democracy. So there's so many more examples I can give. So we should not, they are experts, let me tell you. Do you know how the Mandarin mind thinks? There, none of us can. We don't know Doklam was ordered by Xi Jinping or his army commander or just the local commander. We don't know, and they will never come to know. So what I'm trying to say, 62 mein ye hua. Chauhan and I came here in 1960, I'm going to have a dialogue, we're going to resolve it peacefully. And honestly, he also brought 3 plane loads of material. I mean, 3 planes are not carrying nothing. He had a big delegation, he was ready to make a deal. Okay, ye wala aapka hai, और उधर हमको दे दो. And you talked about Aksaichin Road, ma'am. I can tell you, China is a huge country. Huge country, and it needs connectivity from Xinjiang to Lhasa. If you don't make this road from here, which is coming, you have to come like this and come to Lhasa. How do you like it? This is all no-go. Changtang area is absolutely unlivable. There is no water. People perish. This is a graveyard of caravans and graveyard of animals and human beings. So we are talking of something very difficult. And we have not spent two nights above 12,000. Most of us. If you spend, then you know. The Tibetans say, Lhasa mein aaye hai na, to ye to 12,500 hai, wahan to aur bhi bahut zyada uncha hai jagah. Lekin yahan aaye hai, hamara beer piyo. Have a beer. If you have a beer, you will have a headache. If you don't have it, you will have a heartache. That is right. It's a phrase of temptation. Right? So anyway, ma'am, I hope I've answered your question. Geography cannot be defeated by anybody. And if suddenly there's a huge downpour, snowfall, everything gets stuck. They'll be stuck. And they'll say, kaan phas gaye hum log. So it's not easy. It's not easy. Alright.
I have a question.
No, 1 minute. I have two questions to answer. Alright. You said what more needs to be done for the Chinese. I'll tell you one thing. Firstly, only 13,500 Indian students are studying in China. Should be 1,35,000, if not more. पहले तो भेजो अपने बच्चों को, भाई तुम China जाओ, study, get educated, see their system, learn from them. They are very good civilization, very rich civilization. Ask Ashok Kant, he will tell you. But point is, this is one of the first thing. More people should go and get educated there, and people to people. And we should go and celebrate festivals in China, go and meet people. Diwali वहाँ पे करनी चाहिए छोटी मोटी. बोलो तुम्हारे cracker तुम्हारे देश में भी चलाएंगे हम. हम इंडिया से आए हैं, we'll buy some crackers from yours and do that. People to people contact.
If I may add, there are that number 1,35,000 Pakistanis there.
So there you are. So you see, point at issue is we need to learn some of these things. I'm telling you, I have great pleasure in studying and feeling that I will be able to pass it on. The whole purpose is pass it on, because we are going to carry it upstairs. So that is one thing. And other things are also there. Many other things are there. We can, our strengths are music, Bollywood, Indian food, our dance, and Buddhism. Buddhism ko bhi humne udhar bheja tha. To unke man mein, they have a silent, grudging respect for us. They may not say that you have become powers like us, that they will try to keep us down. And that's why they help Pakistan to keep us down. That's a strategy they're playing. But then it's okay. We will find our ways to come up to being good friends, good neighbors, good competitors. All right. And then first question you asked, that China is at an advantage, but you want to know militarily, diplomatically.
No, I'm saying that your view.
My view. Okay.
Not said.
So you want a clarification? You want a
dark section of the establishment.
Yes. You want to get a clarification from my own experience tells me that I mentioned this in passing, that we should start with the assumption that the Chinese or Chinamen are not 8 feet tall. We are given that impression mostly by our media, and they play our media. You think their Xi Jinping's photographs and video of inspecting some huge parade somewhere here was shown by their media to us and given to our media, you please play these cassettes. So every media channel was playing it every day. And you get, oh my God, look at them, they're watching this, that. It was a very good trick. When will we learn this? I'm afraid we have to be smart. Today, this world is for smart people. Of course, you should be fair and just and everything, but you should be smart. You shouldn't let others take advantage of you. So वो दिखाते हैं हम लोग, हम देखते हैं, everybody says oh war. There's a gentleman, I don't know name, he sits in London, he said war is on the cards, it has to happen. Doklam के कारण war भी, then he kept quiet after that. I'm sure you'll be able to understand, he is a well-known figure. बाल भी है उसका, ऐसा है वैसा है, anyway, whatever it is. He said, and I said, does this man know anything to talk about a war? He should be a good economist, he should be good other thing. But fact is, these kind of people put a scare in the people, and log bolte hain, will there be a war? Okay, now the Chinese, let me tell you, are the most wise people. as a civilization, we are also equally wise, but we should not allow ourselves to be beguiled. We have been repeatedly allowing ourselves to get beguiled, and that should not happen. Now, I must tell you, the Chinese surrounded one of the posts in this area somewhere, and it was during the Kargil war. And the chap told me, I was additional DGMO, sir, ye kiya hai, unhone ye kar rahe hain, wo kar rahe hain. Toh maine kaha, kitne hain, itne hain. Maine kaha, kya kar rahe hain? Kehte hain, abhi toh sirf surround kiya hai. So I said, don't do anything, hold fire, you not do anything. After some time, kya, what is the situation? Wo patthar fek rahe hain. So I said, then you also throw patthar. Unko goli fire karne ka hukum nahi hai. Isliye wo patthar fek rahe hain. Agar attack karna hota, toh dusri kahani hoti. Phir aap bhi usko jawab de sakte ho. Unko hukum mila hai, goli nahi chalani hai. So my point is, they are responsible also. And today is not 62. Let me assure you, in 1962, Times of London says India is going to launch an attack called Operation Leghorn after 4 days. You mean, sir, your operational plans are being discussed in the Times in London, and then Times of India also puts it up 2 days later. What was the need for them to be told, or who told them? How did they come to know? That was our sense of security or secretiveness of operation. Even if it was there, the Chinese say, "Dekho, aap attack karne wale ho, isliye humne preempt kar diya aapko." So I'm trying to say, this is the, we should know, as a democracy, we don't enjoy the privileges which a country like China has, because their decision making is totally opaque, if not totally behind a curtain. Alright, so I've answered militarily, economically, diplomatically. As I said, new breed, even military, our people made blunders. So we have a new breed of leaders, and not now. It was maybe 15-20 years since we have become smart, and we are not going to take it lying down. We will be fair, we will be just, and we will also match whatever we can do.
General Singh, my name is Roy. I am an old soldier. I have served in the areas that you are talking about. In fact, in 66, when I arrived at my post, I had to go through mud for 20 kilometers to arrive at that location, which finally became, I think, a brigade location. I will not mention the location now. I nearly lost my life thrice on the Siang River because I was tasked to cross it. And it could not be crossed with our boats because the current was so swift and so strong. I was saved by the Mahars some 4 kilometers downstream. Now, what pains me to know that my young life was spent defending my country in those areas, and up to now, the development of old Nifa and today's Arunachal Pradesh has not kept a pace. I think this was a policy not to develop roads and to not develop infrastructure, so they get a leg up if they ever came down. The second question which I want to ask you is, in 1954, I believe the Indian government, Nehru's time, gave an assurance in the UN that Tibet is a part of China. I am not very certain, I have not seen old documents. Can you elaborate whether that emboldened China in 1962? Thank you.
Alright. Basically, okay, yeah, let's take one or two questions.
And regard his question, Tibet is part of China. In 1954 agreement, it does not say autonomous region of China, it says region of China. So we gave away China, Tibet to China in 1954 itself, completely. The word autonomous does not figure in the entire agreement.
No, it says autonomous region, part of China.
No, sir, autonomous word is not used.
Even today, we are using the same terminology, am I right?
It is Tibet region of China.
India and Tibet region of China.
That's right.
Autonomous is not used.
Tibet region of China.
Well, what I meant is that they were, between these words, they were understanding that they will get autonomy. Yeah. They will not be part of a regular province of China. So,
sir,
why should we miss that out? Because it's part of the agreement they did. Yes, yeah.
In the entire agreement, the word autonomous does not exist. Number one. Number two, under Nehru, repeatedly said, Tibet was never independent. it had only autonomy. Now, whether it's sovereignty or sovereignty, naturally, there's no such thing as sovereignty. Therefore, sovereignty rested with China. Therefore, Tibet became part of China in a manner of speaking, even earlier. And I would like to ask a question. When a country is only autonomous internally, can it sign away the border? It is sovereign. It is sovereign who signed the border, not the autonomous.
I'll answer this. One more, okay?
Any other question?
Okay. So, I'll take your question first. Anyone?
Yeah. Sure. Keep it very short and question, please.
Okay, Your Excellency, how do you read a 17-point agreement between the Chinese and the Tibetan?
I could not make out, unfortunately. Sorry.
17-point
agreement. No. That is with Tibet.
Tibet.
17. Okay. Now, I must tell you, firstly, I'll answer your question. Development in Arunachal Pradesh, it's not that nothing is happening, but since you served and you said 20 kilometers you walk through bog, marshes, and muck to reach your post, this is a brigade headquarter now. That means it is an important place. Whatever it is, geography and nature has to be faced. So therefore, when we make a road, it rains so heavily, the whole road and the bridge gets washed away. So you have to redo it. And also, as a governor, let me tell you, a railway line has been made joining Itanagar with the Northern Railway in Assam. So people catch a train, it may not be a great distance, but symbolically, Arunachali say, I sit in a train from my capital and I can go to Delhi. So my point is, that has happened. I went over that railway line at least 20, 30 times, asking for progress, asking for progress. Similarly, the roads, Tawang Road, is still under development because it is being made into a four-lane highway. Things are happening, but the pace is not fast enough. And I have been repeatedly telling in my own way, as a governor, I told the Prime Minister, whom else can you tell? And I told the Defence Minister, give border roads more power or give this to other parties, not border roads, give it to civil and private companies which can do it in a faster way. And therefore, things are moving. And I'm told that, yes, we are behind the other side, but doesn't matter, we'll catch up. But we have a system in which we also identify the bottlenecks, they are being taken care of.
I have one more point here.
Yes.
In later life, you know, I was in the civilian establishment, and I went to the same area for development and certain things in Itanagar. The Chinese government put a scope in the ADB loan.
Yes.
We had negotiated for a loan, and the Chinese government put a spoke into it,
yes.
And then we couldn't do it.
Well, you raised an important point that the Chinese have linked up projects in Arunachal as being in disputed areas. So technically, it's a disputed area. So therefore, they said, we also fund into this. We also contribute to this fund, so we have a say. I think that is the place where they must have done it. But they also know that they themselves have done something in POK, which is disputed. So why don't you use the same yardstick there? When you say it should not happen here, why should you do it there? So their CPEC and their One Belt Road Initiative also going through that area which is disputed. So I think we have to question Chinese. Thoda sa humko bhi hoshiyari dikhana padega. We have to be smarter. And therefore, our Mandarins have also gone miles today, as I am saying. I am leaving a message that we are much better equipped to deal with our competitor or neighbor than before. Have I answered? Your question I didn't fully answer. That autonomous, I think the Ambassador Kant has also answered it, that yes, you talked about that autonomy, is it there or not. My view is that China has committed on numerous occasions, since 100 years, and they've gone against their word. So whether it was autonomous or not, they would have done what they are doing now.
It was
a 17-point agreement also. Yeah. So 17-point agreement may be. My only point is, we should know, understand them. Tibetans feel that they have to suffer it, because they feel that they are part of this great big country, which is, they have also signed the 17-point agreement, based on which
they are themselves hamstrung. That yes, we have signed it, our forefathers have signed it, so therefore we have to now accept that reality. Only thing is, in the heart of hearts, what they're feeling, that we can't say, but we can only assume. And Chinese have a challenge over there. They think that India is the cause of, you know, Mao Zedong has said, boundary is not the problem between India and China. It is Tibet. Because the Indians still believe they have a role to play. We said we have no role to play. We have nothing to get ourselves involved in it. But definitely if there is a umbilical cord from centuries ago of civilizational interaction, we can't do much about that. We can't say, no, it's a bad word, don't use it. So that's the way.
Sir, I just wanted to make a supplement to what JJ has said. I just take you.
Okay.
Sir, I was posted there in one of the formation headquarters. Let me tell Brigadier Roy that after we have finished, I should be able to tell you, sir, there's so much of development which has taken place, that is in the area of Arunachal. Excellent. In fact, let me tell you, the communication network and the advanced landing grounds and everything, there are a whole lot of things actually which we cannot bring out in this kind of a
forum.
And you will be actually very happy to know that with the kind of joint venture which has been displayed by all the chiefs, the kind of infrastructure which has come up in the recent few weeks and in the recent few months is exceptional. So you should be very happy about that. I can give you the details about it after.
All right.
My name is Samanji Chaudhary. I wanted to ask a question to General Singh. It's a more general question, really. I understand that the Chinese did some very, very meticulous planning lasting almost 2 years before they launched their attack in 1962. So they are obviously people who plan very carefully before they move. Now, what do you think would be going on in the Chinese mind today after Doklam? And what do you think will be their approach in going forward?
I think a good question. Firstly, I'll go back to the first part of your question was in 62, how much planning they did. Let me tell you, in 1959, they had decided when Dalai Lama came in and we made such a, warm reception for him, they decided in their mind that I think India needs to be cut to size and we must strike a blow, but not see that it goes out of control subsequently, doesn't escalate beyond a certain limit. Second point, and they started working on that since then. You can't suddenly create a Tamil-speaking chap on the border, because in 62 war they said their chaps are speaking Tamil to our soldiers and Gurkhali to our soldiers and Punjabi to our soldiers. That means they had spent effort and time to train such people. So they were all ready. They only wanted an excuse, and that excuse also we gave them, that throw the Chinese out and therefore we are going to launch a counter attack. So they said we will do a defensive counter attack, because it came in the Times in London and Times of India, and everybody was saying army has been told, our politicians said army has been told to throw the Chinese back. So point is, it's disputed area, but then whatever it is, that was the way. Now today, Doklam, not only today, I'll talk about that 62 one. In 62 itself, a few months before that, Mao Zedong had a conference in outskirts of Beijing, in which he gave the task to people that this is what you'll do. And yet, till September 62, they kept talking, we'll settle it by dialogue. That was a cover. That was to lull us into complacency. They knew. How can India, and they blamed India for starting the war. Prime Minister is out of the country, Defense Minister is out of the country, Army DGMO has gone on a sailing trip with an aircraft carrier. Mr. Menon was in UN for something. If a country is going to start a war, they should all be here, logically speaking. And Chief of General Staff Call was having a holiday in Srinagar. So fact is, we were not at all responsible to start the war. We didn't have any warlike preparation. You read General Brigadier Dalvi's book. He said, I was planning to go on leave after working so hard in September, October. if there was a war in the offing and he knew about it or somebody had told him, why would he be doing that? So as a country, we were taken up the garden path by them saying, we'll dialogue, and but actually they meant something else. And they wanted, so that we were so unprepared, because what we performed was a cumulative result of our unpreparedness in every field, militarily, diplomatically, politically, everywhere we were found wanting. So point is, Doklam. I'm sure you're aware that Xi Jinping has changed his hierarchy in the military. He's taken away many senior officers and put them on the shelf. He's put in his key people of his own choice and who are capable, maybe modern. He doesn't want to upset his apple cart at this stage because he knows India is not a pushover anymore and they'll get hurt in the bargain. So he will, the noises which were made finally, whatever it is, Doklam and post-Doklam, everybody says they are looking for an opportunity to do something somewhere else. This kind of thing might happen, small skirmishes, but not resulting in firing, because once you start firing, then it is not easy to stop the escalation. My feeling is that it will perhaps not happen, and both the countries at the highest level have come to some sort of an understanding, are fighting with each other, will help the other countries whose intention is that why don't they have a war, why don't they get into a conflict, so they will perhaps, the strategic balance will go in their favor. The day India and China shake hands, I remember as Chairman Chiefs of Staff Committee, I went to China, I shook hand with the Deputy Chairman of the CMC. I said, sir, when we shake hands, the world sits up and watches. It's there in my first book. What I meant by that is when India and China shake hands, hopefully, if we overcome these boundary issues, which I said are solvable, we might come to the conclusion that both of us in our own way will benefit a lot by holding and shaking hands.
I'm sure there are many more questions, but as time is running out, I'll have to bring this session to a close. So let me, thank General Singh for agreeing to give this special lecture. Today, he has delivered a fascinating and wide-ranging talk, which went well beyond the projected theme, genesis of Shimla conference and impact of McMahon line on boundary negotiations. He has shared with us insights gleaned from a lifetime of studying these issues as Governor of Arunachal Pradesh, as Army Chief, as a scholar in many other capacities. It has been a privilege for us, sir, to host this talk along with the India International Center. So please join me in giving a big round of applause to General Singh.